Greetings. I'm Braxton Hunter. I'm the president of Trinity College of the Bible and Theological Seminary. And I'm having a discussion today with our vice president of academic affairs, Dr. Johnathan Pritchett. And we're talking about issues that we think people should consider in making a choice about the Bible college or seminary that they plan to attend. Obviously, we're a little bit biased. We think that Trinity College of the Bible and Theological Seminary is the right choice, but we think this list will be helpful even if you decide not to attend our seminary. So we'd like to talk about some of those things with you today and hopefully give you a little more information that will be helpful for you. So, Johnathan, thanks for sitting down with us today to have this discussion.
My pleasure.
Now, I think probably you would agree with me that the most important thing, and I think those viewing this video would agree as well, the most important thing when you're making any major life decision, especially with something like theological education, is that you bathe that issue in prayer.
Absolutely. This is a, we can't underestimate the life-changing experience that seminary is for almost everyone I know that has ever attended seminary. And to think that you would go into that unprepared, having not spent, I mean, you can never spend enough time in prayer, but at least an enormous amount of your time seeking the Lord's face and guidance and where you are going to spend years of your life.
Yes, you know? And under whom you're going to place yourself in terms of guidance in studying major doctrinal issues.
Right. And there's a lot of things to consider. Your Are you single? Are you married? Do you have a family? What are your current expenses? Seminary does cost money. What is God's will for your life?
Yes, and when we're talking about studying the Bible and trying to model Jesus as best we can, it's interesting to note that one of the few things, if not the only thing, that Jesus sat down with his disciples and specifically taught them how to do, step by step, is prayer.
Absolutely.
And so we think you should bathe this issue in prayer. But you probably thought that already. You probably are committed to a life of prayer. We certainly hope so. And that leads us into a discussion of what your other beliefs might be. And beliefs are important because even though anyone who is an Orthodox Christian is going to affirm certain fundamental things, doctrinal issues can become divisive and debated issues, and we see that going on in churches. Churches are splitting over what we would consider perhaps secondary but important doctrinal issues. And so your doctrinal issues, your doctrinal views should come into play as you're trying to decide what school to attend. There are certain seminaries that I couldn't attend because I might think they're a bit too theologically liberal on a particular issue or too focused on one particular perspective. So talk to us a little bit about that issue when people choose how their doctrinal views come into play.
Well, there are several types of people here. The first type of person that we could talk about when it comes to doctrinal views is the unsettled person, the person who is a Christian. They recognize the value of going to seminary for full-time or vocational ministry, even part-time perhaps. They see, I don't want to just sit out here without any guidance. I see the value in learned men and women teaching me and testing me. So maybe this person is also thinking, I affirm the fundamentals of the faith, the essential doctrines.
Things like the bodily resurrection of Jesus, the virgin birth,
the Trinity,
the return of Christ, these kinds of things.
The infallibility and the inspiration and the authority and the inerrancy of Scripture, right? Those fundamental, I believe those, but this person says, I'm not decided yet on where I might land on eschatology or what is the proper view of the gifts, the spiritual gifts. What is the proper mode of baptism? What about this Calvinism debate that we hear a lot about? All of these different issues, and you might be this type of person that wants to learn. What the best type of seminary for that person is one that is open to presenting, not necessarily affirming, but presenting all of the views.
Yes. At a good theological seminary, and we certainly think this is true of Trinity, we want to present the spread among conservative, orthodox, evangelical positions. So in our teaching, yours and mine, if there are three possible views for a person who is a Bible-believing Christian, and it's just a debated issue among particular denominations or perspectives. We want to present those fairly and try to present them in the way that is strongest and most appropriate to what those who hold that view might say.
Right.
But then we'll also tell you what our views are. But we think that that's responsible because that allows the student to assess these things and make an informed decision for themselves.
Right. And of course, with a seminary like Trinity, you'll get exposed to all of that in your textbook literature. You'll get exposed to that from professors who hold a variety of views. But also, because we are apologetics fans here, we are very enthusiastic about evangelism. We will also even look at some of the liberal scholars, but will show from a conservative confessional perspective why they're wrong. You know,
yeah, so I don't want my children. I have two daughters, and I don't want my children to be ignorant of what theologically liberal people or atheists are saying. I want them to be aware of those things. Right. I want them to learn how to respond to those positions in a safe environment, like you would find in a seminary, where we can look at these views, look at these perspectives, and put them through the ringer so that we know now when a theologically liberal person shows up at our local church, or when someone in our church or a friend or even we ourselves hear something on the internet, and we think, well, I wonder how a person should respond to that. We'll have those at our disposal.
Right. So is the doctrinal perspective of the seminary narrow or wider? That's the key issue here. If it is one of the more older mainline denomination seminaries or divinity schools, maybe an Ivy League divinity school like Duke or Vanderbilt, the type of seminary student that's already unfortunately enamored with horrible liberal scholarship that seeks to undermine the Word of God, Trinity is not going to be the kind of atmosphere for that kind of person. But we do want that person to come to Trinity to be rid of those sorts
of so if you took beliefs, a look at our statement of faith on Trinity's website, what you'll find is a very minimal statement, which allows for people from a variety of doctrinal perspectives and various denominations and non-denominations, but it's still going to place you firmly in the theologically conservative camp and orthodox. And so that's what we want. You know, a lot of people that come here come from major denominations like the Southern Baptist Convention, for example, which is, you know, pretty conservative theologically, and yet they are overwhelmingly pleased with the fact that, hey, I didn't necessarily only hear my view. I heard from people in my class. My professor, perhaps, is from another denomination. We don't agree on everything, but it was certainly conservative and faithful to the Bible.
Absolutely, and that's the kind of doctrinal positions we take here at Trinity. So the doctrinal views of a seminary are going to be very important, and even some people might be left of our school. We still want that student to come here, like I said before, because we hope that they would get exposed to sound biblical teaching. So,
yeah, if you're out there and you are you lean more left in terms of theology. Now, remember, we're not talking about necessarily politics. That's not what we're discussing here. But theologically liberal, you know, I think I would look at a school like this as an interesting way to hear what these conservatives are saying and have maybe more street cred in discussing with conservatives in the future, because you've heard from their sources. So we think it's a good opportunity for you. That brings us to a discussion of denomination. Perhaps you are a member of the United Methodist Church or the Assemblies of God or perhaps a Southern Baptist, and you think, is it okay? How will people view me? Should I go to a school that is non-denominational? What do you say to that, Dr. Pritchett? I think I have an answer, but I'd like to hear what you have to say.
My answer is yes, because what you will find is you will find other United Methodists, Southern Baptists, Assemblies of God folks at multi-denominational schools or interdenominational schools or non-denominational, whatever language you want to use. So yes, you will find other people like you. We're one of the larger seminaries in the United States. And so a large seminary like us that's non-denominational. We have them from many different denominations, both represented in our student body, represented in our faculty. And in fact, there are reasons why people who are part of a particular denomination actually choose a school like seminary, like Trinity, because sometimes their own denominational schools charge more than they can afford to attend. Mm-hmm. And because in a lot of these denominations, they know that they want to faithfully serve the Lord in a church that may have less than 150 people or so, they don't want to invest the tens of thousands of dollars because they're not in this for the money. They're in this to serve the Lord in smaller churches. And reasonably considering the costs and what their income would be from such a church, it doesn't quite work out for them.
Yeah.
So they choose... Even mainline Protestant denominations like the Presbyterian Church of America or the Lutheran Missouri Synod, or even I think the United Methodists, I'm not for sure because I'm not one, but some of those or many of those do require the Master of Divinity degree to be ordained. And many people from even those denominations come to Trinity to get the Master of Divinity simply on the basis of cost, as opposed to their own denominational schools.
Yeah, and that's a relevant point. We'll discuss that more, I think, in a few moments. But a thing to highlight here, I think, would be that we have doctoral students, for example, who do their dissertation based on something within their own denomination. So we have people here doing work on Southern Baptist research and research within the United Methodist Church. And so you can still be very active in your own denomination in terms of your research and writing at Trinity, even though Trinity is a non-denominational school.
Sure. We had a student who the Nazarene Churches, they funded not only his program, but they funded his, he was doing an empirical studies for their denomination and their Sunday school curriculums and the level of education in various regions.
Yeah.
And so they actually paid for his research expenses on in addition to paying for his program.
Fantastic.
So, yeah, and that's only doable through seminaries like Trinity, you know, that may not have been affordable to that denomination had he had pursued his doctorate elsewhere.
Okay. Let's talk a little bit then about another issue that I think is important for people to consider, and that is, who am I going to be learning from? Who are my professors going to be, and are they quality professors? Are they recognized in their field? Now, I'll just go ahead and say, again, we're biased here. You're viewing this on our seminary's website, probably, but the thing about it is, we think that a good professor is one who you're going to see them doing things outside of the classroom. You're going to find that they are engaging in the academic literature, that they're publishing journal articles, that they're preaching and speaking and doing evangelistic work and are engaged in academic debates on issues, perhaps. In other words, you want to know that your professors are recognized in their field outside of just that local seminary. And so many schools out there that are Bible colleges and seminaries, especially of the variety you find that have online programs like ours, unfortunately, so often, those professors, though they may be good people and well-intentioned, don't have that sort of presence outside of the seminary that you can just kind of Google their name and find what they're doing. At Trinity, we are blessed to have professors that are widely recognized. So why don't you talk a little bit about some of the professors that you work with all the time here at Trinity and what they're doing for the Lord within and without our school.
Right. And I don't want to just limit to what they're doing in the their particular fields with respect to academia, but also in ministry.
Right.
Because that is also very important. Not only are they recognized in their field as accomplished scholars, but are they recognized as humble servants of the Lord, you know, in the ministry fields, plowing and doing the Lord's work there.
Amen.
And a seminary like Trinity, it, like you said, is extremely blessed to have top-notch faculty that do both and have done both and continue to do both. So, first of all, you are, in addition to being president, are also a faculty member, and you have published many books in journal articles and have shared the stage with the elite conservative Christian apologists, not just only in the United States, but all over the world.
Well, I've been blessed to have that opportunity,
right.
Yes.
So the books, the debates, the traveling. But in addition to that, you go to any church anywhere for a love offering to hold old-fashioned, or what people are calling now old-fashioned, but they should never go out of fashion, revivals, crusades,
yeah.
Winning people for the Lord, having church members sure. bring lost friends to church to hear a rousing gospel message and coming to know Jesus at the end of it. That's something that you have done all of your life, and no matter what you're doing in academics, you continue to do that to this day.
Yeah,
all
people
the
describe
and the world.
People describe, and I appreciate those kind comments. People describe what I do as kind of having a foot in two separate worlds. I don't actually view it that way at all, and I view what I do as a representation of what our school represents, which is the combination of practical ministry and evangelism, reaching people with the gospel message. In whatever form that may take, and the academic side of that, which for me manifests itself in terms of defense of the scriptures, defense of God's existence, defense of Christianity. And so you'll find me at conferences with people like William Lane Craig and Lee Strobel, but you'll also find me, like you said, preaching perhaps under a tent or in a small church
right.
somewhere. And you said a love offering, I don't even require any financial gift to come and speak at a church, because that's part of what we do. We believe that God is blessing our school because of our interest in evangelism and ministry and seeing things happen in the local church and seeing people get saved. So yes, I think you're very kind to mention me,
right.
but I'm only one of several.
Right.
Let me go ahead and return the favor.
Okay.
Dr. Johnathan Pritchett, and as recently as just several months ago, had a live theological debate in Houston, Texas, with graduates of Southern Baptist Theological Seminary on a doctrinal issue. And we consider people that differ from us on issues like that to be brothers and sisters in Christ. But in that debate, Dr. Pritchett was with a fellow Trinity professor, Dr. Leighton Flowers, and just did a fantastic job. And that debate was reviewed and discussed by some of the movers and shakers in the theological world today,
yeah.
men like James White, for example, who you may be aware of from Alpha and Omega Ministries. So these are, at least with myself and Dr. Pritchett, you could Google us and find where we've written things, contributed to things, and spoken and done debates. But I think some people who are aware of our school because of our online presence may think, well, okay, they've got Dr. Hunter and Dr. Pritchett. Do they have anybody else that's doing things like that? And of course, we do, don't we?
Oh, absolutely. Dr. Roy Hartness, for example, is he is the ideal professor in my view, because not only is he academically solid, but he is a faithful Southern Baptist preacher in season and out of season for decades, and he's out there in Tennessee, and if he has that academic knowledge that he combines and experience, and of course he's also involved in local education there in Tennessee as well.
Mm-hmm.
He's actually sat on the school board, ensuring that the public school system there doesn't go nutty,
yeah.
like it's going nutty in a lot of places. Very
sure.
active in that as
yeah.
well. But just a faithful gospel preacher, and he guides those students from that perspective of combining the head knowledge with the heart knowledge and
that's
the heart
what we
passion.
Do.
Right. And so I love to brag on Roy.
Oh, yeah.
And then of course, Dr. Chatham, accomplished psychologist, clinical therapist, teaches from our biblical counseling program, very accomplished in that field, but also an accomplished theologian as well.
Yes.
But he pastored he's retired from pastoring now. He pastored a church for large churches, in fact. So,
yes, of I think 1,500 members.
Right, and it's unique to have professors that have both been kind of more on the megachurch side and the the small church side, because we get students like that from
That's right.
One of our...
And we believe that there may be small churches, but there are not small ministries.
Absolutely. Then you look at probably someone who's more recognized in the theological field, Dr. Leighton Flowers, of course, mm-hmm. who we just loved tremendously, just an incredible, honorable man of God. His passion for evangelism, his passion for theology, his passion for writing books, his passion for getting information out there, for taking all of this stuff that we do in seminary and getting it out in a way that even the layman in the church who maybe doesn't have a college degree can even understand, and it brings them in to the conversation as well. That's one of his passion projects, is to always bring in everyone else who may not ever get to have a seminary. They're in other vocations. They don't get mm-hmm. to get exposed to all this stuff, but they want to be informed, and he's the kind of guy who his public ministry is evangelism, it is preaching, it is writing academic theology books, it is writing layman articles for people, it is hosting a podcast.
Yes, and that debates. Podcast right. has thousands and thousands of views
right.
every week, and as recently as as of this recording, he most recently had one of the most famous pastors in America, Andy Stanley,
yeah.
on his show. And that may be a controversial thing to some people, but he has all kinds of people on to discuss what's going on in the church and what's going on in the world of theology.
Sure. And he has, in addition to that, he has our colleagues from other seminaries, Southern Baptist seminaries.
Yeah.
You'll see him interact with David Allen, for example, at
sure.
Southwestern. So one of the things that I like about Leighton Flowers is he's so cordial, and he's so, because he has such a big view of God and God's love, he has a big view of God's people and thinks that, whether they differ on some things or than he does or not, they're still brothers and sisters in Christ, and he wants to work with everyone who's interested in spreading the gospel.
Right.
And so, right. Whether it's academics or his ministry down there in Texas through the Texas Baptist, I think we're very blessed to have him.
We certainly are, and he's another one that has had theological debates
right.
that were very, very public and with
right.
extremely well-known scholars on the other side. Now, we can't go through every one of our professors, unfortunately. We just don't have time for that. That could be its own episode. But I do want to highlight at least one other person, and then you can highlight a couple other people
okay.
from your side. But Dr. Steve Gregg. If you were to visit thenarrowpath.com, which is Steve Gregg's website, you would find a verse-by-verse through the entire Bible. We're talking about thousands and thousands of hours. And these are not sermons, although he has little sermonic points. But these are major lectures through
right.
the themes and doctrines that emerge in every book of the Bible. And I have listened to his entire New Testament and most of the Old Testament, and he has a number of topical lectures as well. And this is a person that has also traveled all over the world with groups like YWAM and has also debated major skeptics, atheists, and also people theologically and people that are leaders of cults, and just making a huge impact in the world, and has a regular radio program across America.
Yeah.
And so we're very proud to have him teaching a class on Revelation, a class on, Deuteronomy. And so we're thrilled to have him here. And these are all, again, I want to highlight, these are all people who you can see making a difference in and out of the classroom. Who else would you like to highlight before we move on?
Well, I would be remiss if we didn't highlight our Christian counseling and life coaching programs with Dr. Ingrid Buckwagler and Dr. Daphne Washington, who they combined psychological and emotional connection to the faith. You know, we are incarnate, embodied creatures that God has created. We have rational faculties, we have emotional faculties, and the people in our churches have those. The people in our churches have various life issues that come in to play. And so I just think our whole school of Christ-centered counseling with Dr. Chatham, Dr. Buckwagler, and Dr. Washington is absolutely outstanding. And of course, Professor Kirby's in there, and Professor DeWitt. So I don't want to. A lot of people come either for the biblical counseling or the Christian counseling here. We offer both. Maybe we can talk about some programs later. But Doctors Buckwagler and Washington, they really offer a unique perspective of embracing that picture of Revelation 7:9, you know, people from every tribe, tongue, and nation coming together. How do you deal in churches when you're ministering to all different types of people? And our programs in that department, they are leading the field, mm-hmm. you know.
Yes, if you have a school like ours, right. that is a school that has students in multiple countries around the world, then it makes sense to have professors who are both men and women and of various national backgrounds, and we're proud to have that here.
Yeah, and they are, it's cutting edge in our Christian counseling department, and of course that flows over to the, also we have life coaching programs, because that's becoming a major field as well.
Yeah, Trinity's long been known for its counseling programs, and in terms of other schools catching up, let me just say this. We're biased, but one area where we think that Trinity has a strength that few other schools, if any other school, has this strength, is you want to pick a school, a Bible college or a seminary, where, especially with an online program where this can fall through the cracks so easily, believe it or not, is you want a school where you're going to actually get to see and hear from your professor a lot. You know, one of the things we're trying to do as an online school is to minimize the difference between being in an online classroom and being in a brick and mortar classroom. And we really believe we're approaching a time here where if there is a difference at all, the only difference is that you're not breathing the same oxygen as your professor.
Right.
Aside from that, you can interact with other students, you can interact with your professor, you can work with other students on projects if you so choose, and with the professors that we have now, we require that in every class at the Bible college level, there are several hours of video lecture from each professor, so from your Trinity professor, so that you can see and hear them and get their heart, something you can't get from just seeing text on a screen. And then at the seminary level, we have at least 8 hours of video lecture in every single class. And that's in addition to the reading from incredible books you're going to do and the interactions with other students, so that when you get done with a Trinity course, you will have heard from your professor, you will have learned from them for hours on end, and you can replay those videos if you so choose. And you've gotten to know the other students and really developed a camaraderie with those other people that are in the class. Now, I don't want to be critical of other schools, but I want to say this. I am currently in a program at another seminary. And what I've found is that, unfortunately, other schools often in their online programs just do not have a video component, or if they do have a video or audio component, it's somewhat minimal, perhaps 10 or 15 minutes a week, something like that. Depending on the school, you might get more. But I've not encountered anything that is as robust as what we have here at Trinity in terms of how we offer those courses. And the last thing I want to say about that is, because we have students in other countries, and perhaps you're watching from somewhere where when it's daytime here in Evansville, Indiana, it's midnight where you're at. And so with this format, you're able to get those lectures when it's convenient for you.
Yes, I would like to expound on that just a little bit, because we have students who have come in from other seminaries that are online distance and have said that they have never seen so much interaction before with their professors or their online. We've even had people who come in from brick and mortar campuses to making that transition. They were nervous about it. They come to Trinity and they realize, I have spoken more either one-on-one or in small group with my professors, that, you know, whether it's Skype or whether it's online in some sort of forum or social media, than I ever got to engage sitting in a lecture hall with 70 people and never once going to the professor's office or even being able to get in to see him or her or whatever. And people come to Trinity and they cannot believe how accessible our faculty is. If you want to interact with our faculty, we put them out there.
Yes,
spend hours on the phone, hours on Facebook. We have a discussion forum on Facebook for Trinity students. We have Skype and Google Hangouts has made all of this possible. There's so many different ways to interact with students that even people on brick and mortar campuses don't even have the same kind of student to student and student to faculty interactions that Trinity has been able to create. So if you're considering a seminary, it's not about, like you said, the difference is whether or not you breathe the same oxygen, you know, but that's true. But another thing you need to consider is even if you breathe the same oxygen, is it going to be enough? Is the same oxygen actually interaction, or are you just occupying the same space? Whereas even if you're not breathing the same oxygen, you're on a screen, but you get to visit with your professors, you get to visit with your other students and build those relationships. You need to consider whether brick and mortar or online seminary, are you going to have the kind of engagement that you are looking for?
Right, and it's so great to walk through the halls here at Trinity and hear our professors on the phone or interacting through social media and having theological discussions with their students and in the classroom, the course classroom.
Yeah.
And also, hey, pray for me. My daughter's sick, and I don't know what it is, and it's been going on for weeks, and we're really concerned. And crying with our students and praying with them, and real mentorship, not just in terms of the academics, but also in terms of just your spiritual walk. And I think that is a value in and of itself, apart from the education that just comes on top of it. So we have that. Now, we don't want to go through all the programs. We don't really have enough time to do that. But highlight the major divisions that we have, that people, what kind of degrees people can pursue, and what makes a degree at Trinity in one of those programs different in terms of the structure and the format and those sorts of things from other schools.
Well, sure. If you were to visit Trinity's website, what you'll see is Trinity is divided into four areas. We call them schools. Four schools. You have the School of Biblical and Theological Studies, you have the School of Integrated Apologetics, you have the School of Christ-Centered Counseling, and you have the School of Practical Ministry. And those all sound basically self-explanatory.
Mm-hmm.
So in the School of Biblical and Theological Studies, the degree programs in that are going to be pertaining to studying the intricacies of the Bible and the background to the Bible and the languages of the Bible and doctrines, you know, biblical theology or systematic theology, things like that.
Mm-hmm.
That's where that is emphasis. But we emphasize that in all of our programs. So it's not like if you don't study a biblical studies or theology program that you don't get biblical studies or theology in any of the other schools. And like people who are in those programs, whether it's elective or part of that program, you're going to end up taking apologetics or some sort of preaching course or things like that. So there is interplay. But if you're looking for a degree where your primary focus is theology and biblical studies, you go to the School of Biblical Studies and Theology.
Mm-hmm.
If you're interested and you want to be a pastor or you want to be a ministry leader in a parachurch organization, or you want to be an associate pastor, or even a youth pastor, or you want to be, you know, an itinerant evangelist. We're big on that. Degree programs in the School of Practical Ministry are going to be more oriented towards that person. You're still going to get plenty of Bible at Trinity. You're going to get plenty of theology at Trinity. But the programs there are geared to training up those who want to in some kind of ministry or pastoral capacity. The School of Christ-Centered Counseling. School of Christ-Centered Counseling is pretty self-explanatory. It's going to be biblical counseling, which is just counseling straight from the biblical text, probably in a church atmosphere or setting or parachurch organization. Christian counseling is more integrationist, and they have a lot of interesting discussions between those two degree programs.
Well, which is why there is a debate about methodology between biblical and integrationist or Christian counseling that most people are not even aware of, even most seminarians are not aware of. And because of that, usually when you go to a Bible college or seminary, you get one or the other that school offers. But at Trinity, again, as a non-denominational school, number one, not that this is a denominational specific issue, but it's that idea that we want to show both options and let the student make a decision. And so when we offer a program, hey, you pray about it, you think about it, and these professors may not even agree amongst themselves about all these details.
Right.
But you need to choose under the guidance of the Holy Spirit what path in counseling is right for
right.
you. So again, what you're seeing is flexibility in the format, in what kind of program you get into, and even in the nuances between the different ideas in a issue like counseling.
Sure. And then, of course, finally, what's near and dear to both of our hearts, but more yours than mine probably, is the School of Integrated Apologetics. And we call it Integrated Apologetics because while certain apologetic methods might be more pronounced in one professor's ministry as opposed to another, we emphasize the best of all of it, mm-hmm. and we call it Integrated Apologetics because our main thing is not one type of apologetic versus another. Our main thing is evangelism. And evangelism is something that we connect very closely. You wrote a book called Evangelistic Apologetics because apologetics, a defense of the Christian faith, is in service to your ministry of evangelizing to other people. So that's some schools emphasize, and this might be when you're considering a seminary and you're interested in apologetics, you think, do they have the presuppositional approach or do they have cumulative case approach? I like that. Do they have the classical apologetics? Is it cultural apologetics? The interesting thing about Trinity is we're yes to all of them. What we mainly do is we want to reach people for Christ with our apologetics. In your book, you talk about how apologetics sometimes becomes this little niche kind of mental entertainment, but not necessarily...
Unfortunately, yeah. In a lot of schools, there is a tendency... They do a great job teaching a particular perspective on apologetics, the defense of the Christian faith. But what I found a lack of, and what makes Trinity unique, is we connect, and as you said, it's integrated for this reason. We integrate apologetics and evangelism. We believe that evangelism should be at the core of what we do in Christian apologetics. Apologetics can have a benefit in terms of building up the faith of those who already believe. But what's the point of defending Christianity but that people might believe Christianity is true?
Amen.
And so what's different about Trinity, I think, is we connect the practical evangelism to everything we do in Christian apologetics while still talking about all the ivory tower ideas and philosophical issues and that come up with Christian apologetics. And as you said, we teach all the different methodologies here because we want to give you every tool for your apologetic toolkit, and then we want you to use it not just for your own mental stimulation or for guys like me and Dr. Pritchett to sit around after church on Sunday and talk about some new book we read, some argument we heard, or some debate that we watched. No. We want you to do something with it.
That's
and
right.
Do something beyond argue with people on the internet. We
right.
want people to use it to change the world for Jesus. And so I hope you can hear my heart out about that. Many of the students that come into our apologetics program say they chose it because they liked the philosophy we have about it's all about evangelism. And unfortunately, not many schools or books today are emphasizing that connection that we see as crucial that kind of makes the apologetic endeavor matter a little
right.
bit more.
Absolutely.
So that's our academics are flexible, solid, and under each of those schools, there are various programs that you could enroll in. And then even after you enroll in a program, you have electives where you can kind of make that program a little more nuanced toward your doctrinal positions, your interests in ministry. And so I hope, again, you're seeing that there's flexibility in what we offer here at Trinity. So let's move on now and talk about whether people have seen success in this. And of course, we have a page on our website that is the prominent graduates page.
Expanding all the time as we see more and more of our graduates making an impact for Jesus on national or even international stages. Now, I want to preface this by saying if your name is not on that prominent graduate list, it's probably... because we just don't...
We're not aware of it yet.
Right, because many of our graduates are the unsung heroes of the global Christian church.
That's right.
Everywhere. But people do ask questions about, well, what are your graduates doing? Have I heard of any of them? When we say prominent, we're not saying these are our best, because many of our graduates are doing outstanding work.
That's a
for
good
the Lord
point
everywhere.
To make. Someone who's doing small church ministry,
right?
Small church, big ministry. Yeah. Those kind of people are, we think, as important to the work of the kingdom as those who are more visible in public. But people want to know, is getting a degree from this school, and you want to ask this about whatever school you're considering, this is why this is on the list of things you should consider.
Are they doing anything?
Is this unlocking doors for them? Right. Is their degree allowing them to go places in ministry that, for better or worse, not having a degree wouldn't allow? And so is this unlocking those doors? And I'm proud to say that we have graduates who have become presidents of accredited Bible colleges and seminaries. We have had graduates who are department heads at other schools, accredited and unaccredited. We have people who are professors at all kinds of schools. They're pastoring mega churches and small churches. We even in the Southern Baptist Convention, the North American Mission Board, which is the Southern Baptist Convention's arm for doing evangelism and ministry and church planting in North America. They have the map divided into, I think, five sections, and the entire western half of the United States is one section. And the guy who is over all of that for the largest non-Catholic denomination in the United States is a Trinity graduate.
That's right.
And so we have people in major denominational positions. I don't want to talk too much about myself, but with only Trinity degrees, I became the president of the Conference of Southern Baptist Evangelists, which is a denominational arm of the Southern Baptist Convention. And we have Trinity students who have been written books that are published by major publishers. We have students who have been a part of projects and journal articles and things like that. Just this year, I was allowed to be in and hosting, and you were allowed the opportunity to write the part of the narration for a major documentary that in Turkey about the seven churches. We were flown over there and brought in. So this opens up all kinds of doors with a degree from a school
Absolutely.
Like Trinity.
So if
whatever school you're considering, you want to look at what are those graduates doing, and is this presenting a roadblock to them, not at all helping them, or is it unlocking doors? And I'm proud to say, as the president of Trinity, that Trinity degrees are unlocking doors. And now we can't promise, and no school can promise, that every other school is going to take transfer credits, or every other entity is going to grant you employment on the basis of having a degree from Trinity. But no school can guarantee that. What we can say is there are a lot of opportunities, and we rarely ever hear about doors being closed. We almost always only hear about doors being opened.
That's right.
Right.
And so what you really want, what I think we're both saying here, is what you really want is, when you're trying to pick a school, you want one that is the nexus of credible in terms of its name recognition and also its reputation, its ability to unlock doors for you, but also one that hits that cost, that it's reasonable. And,
sure.
You know, we have said before, and it may sound a little bit offensive to some, but I'll just say it, we charge tens of thousands of dollars to go to a school and then get out of that school. And what you're going to do is, in ministry, let's face it, often you're going to have a job, at least initially. We shouldn't call it a job, a ministry as a pastor or as a counselor or something. And you may not make, you know, $40,000-$50,000 a year at first.
Or a seminary professor.
And now you've got the debt that someone with a secular degree who's going to be an engineer or something, you've got that kind of a debt, but you don't have that kind of an
salary,
income.
Right.
And we think that that is problematic, to say the least.
Yeah.
And so let's talk a little bit about cost then as it comes to Trinity. What do we try to do? Flexibility has been a theme here, and we're flexible with cost. I would just point out to you that what you're going to do is, number one, you're not going to finish that Trinity degree without paying everything that you owe. And paying what you owe is going to be much more of a doable thing for you in a relatively short period of time, because what we charge per credit hour, and especially with grants, and most students qualify for some kind of a grant, and with those grants, you're not going to pay usually what our list price is, what our tuition, full tuition price is on the website. You're going to pay something much less than that, and you're going to finish that program having paid, I don't think we're going out of what's reasonable to say, you're going to finish that program having paid less than what most people would pay for one semester or maybe two semesters at a brick and mortar school or some other school.
Or online school.
This level of credibility.
Right, or an online school that has this level of credibility. Right. They're going to pay. But at Trinity, one of the things that I think is most appealing to our students is the credible degree for an incredible price.
Yeah. It's one of those things that, you know, you hear people say, well, if it sounds too good to be true, then it probably is. Not with this. And the reason is because for 50 years, Trinity has been devoted to providing quality education, quality theological education in a flexible way. And we've already talked a little bit about the what it's like being online, and we've already covered that really. So really what we're coming to now is in a flexible way at a cost that we think is acceptable in God's eyes and reasonable for the student. Yeah. We know that students can't leave their churches and uproot and come to a actual campus and go. Oftentimes, we want those students on the ministry field doing what God's called them to do. And what this sort of thing allows for is for them to do that in a cost-effective way from home and continue living out their ministry and living out their mission without having to uproot their family and without having to go into an incredible amount of debt.
Yes, one of the things I'm particularly proud of is that most of our students either are currently in some sort of ministry right now, or soon after they've started, not got their degree, started their program, within a year or so, they find themselves, God is putting them in their ministry. And thank God they didn't have to pack up and move. Some of them with their wife and kids or their spouses are pregnant. I know of some of our students that are in these situations right now who, had they left, that ministry opportunity that was there for them that God had
would have evaporated.
Would not have been there. So they stayed where they were, and just soon after getting into Trinity, they've already found their ministry, and they're able to do their ministry. And because of the flexibility of our program, Trinity has always been on the cutting edge of distance education. I think that there are some seminaries that have caught up to our model from 10 years ago, but we're past that. And, yeah. You know, so we keep working very hard here to respect our students' time, respect their income, their pocketbooks, their life situation. We work hard to respect their intelligence and their intellect that God has gifted them, so that we give them the right kind of theological training to help them where they are.
Now, listen to me. I want to share something with you as you're considering what school to go to. You want a school that you feel like God's led you to through a season of prayer, a school that is committed to the Word of God without question and will not compromise on its theological convictions, but is broad enough in those secondary doctrinal perspectives to have professors that represent them, to have students that are allowed to write papers and are not graded down because they disagree with their professor on a secondary doctrinal issue. And I want to stress something to you as we close here, and it's this. When you're prayerfully considering something as serious as this, if you believe that God has called you to gospel ministry, whether that's as an apologist, as a counselor, as a pastor, as an evangelist, as a New Testament scholar, whatever it is, you should expect that the enemy is going to attack and that the enemy is going to try and throw up roadblocks. What we've tried to do at Trinity is to remove as many of those obstacles as we possibly can, but here's what we can't remove. We can't remove the obstacles that come to you that sometimes you wouldn't even anticipate. What some family member or some friend or other pastor might bring up. Well, you know, I just think you need to go to this school because it's the school that everyone in our community goes to, or I don't know if it's the right time for you to go to seminary or Bible college. Listen to me. Sometimes the enemy will attack, even through those people who are well-meaning in our lives, who love us so much that they don't want to see us do something that might be the wrong decision from a practical perspective. We've tried to make it practical, but listen, if God wants you to begin your theological education, why wait? He's not confused about what he wants you to do. And I'm not trying to give you a sales pitch, but I don't think it's any mistake that you landed here and that you watched this video all the way to the end. We'll be praying for you. Whether you go to Trinity or somewhere else, we'll be praying that you make the right decision. But I promise you this, if you come to Trinity, if you enroll in one of our programs, you will enter into not just an organization that doesn't know your name, but a family that's there for you, that's going to love you, that's going to pray for you, that's not just going to agree with everything that you say, but is going to push back and challenge you, put you through a time of testing, and you're going to challenge us. It's a journey that can begin for you that will be life-changing and could change the world for the kingdom. And if you're ready to do that, contact us. We'd love to talk with you about that. And even if you're not ready to make that decision today, we won't try to press you with that. But we'd love to begin the conversation. We'd like you to start your theological journey with Trinity today.